Well, it just occurred to me there was one other issue here that I needed to basically run over, which is quite briefly. And that I talked about the United States supplying the British with enriched uranium for the atomic bombs, and presumably therefore also the formula how to make the hydrogen bomb. In fact, there was a BBC documentary that I was involved in, I think in 2004. The producer was Michael Thompson, and it was in the series called Document, and it's since been taken off the internet, off the web, but it was on the web at one point, and in fact I did have a tape of it, but somebody stole it. But this series Document, what it did is it found a load of documents that showed that the British didn't know how to make a hydrogen bomb. They just didn't know how to. And it's not straightforward, you have to figure it out. And they hadn't figured it out. So you have the position that Sir William Penny and his merry men at the atomic weapons establishment have all this pressure coming on them to make this hydrogen bomb so that Britain could have a seat at the high table. And you have to recollect that by 1954 onwards, Britain's role in the world was like rapidly going down the toilet. And the reason for that is that Britain had spent a huge amount of money in the Second World War defeating the Germans and was basically bankrupt. And the only reason that they defeated the Germans was because the Americans stepped in and loaned them, didn't give them, but loaned them lots of weaponry, bombs and ammunition and equipment and ships and so forth. And that meant that the British had to pay the Americans back. And it soon became apparent that the Americans were not going to be helpful in this regard and write off the debts or anything, but to use that as a weapon over the British. Because when the British went to invade Egypt after the Suez Canal crisis, it was the Americans that pulled the British out. And we're not quite sure exactly how that happened. We certainly know that it was American influence or threats that forced the British to pull out of Egypt. And that was a terrible situation for British supremacy in the world. I mean, when I was young, the British had control of the oceans, had control of the colonies, and most of the Atlas was pink. But after the war, it rapidly lost its pink sheen because Britain gave back all of these dependencies and protectorates and colonies and so forth. So Britain was just dependent upon producing a nuclear weapon. Now, clearly Britain didn't produce a nuclear weapon. The first three or four or five tests that were carried out after the Australians threw the British out of Australia, because fallout from the tests in the Montebello Islands in Western Australia was actually crossing over the whole of Australia, and it was being detected by instruments and by measurements in the thyroid glands of sheep, organised by a man called Hedley Marston, who was like an early version of me, I suppose, or I'm a later version of him. And he had a terrible fight with the Australian authorities and with the British to stop the testing over there, and he argued that the physicists who were doing the testing, just exactly as I do, had no idea whatever about the effects that the fallout would have on people exposed to it, and we still don't know because nobody's done the studies. But Hedley Marston was pursued and persecuted and attacked and so forth, but he stuck to his guns and eventually managed to publish a paper which showed that there were high levels of radioactivity coming across Australia from the tests that were done in the Montebello Islands. So the British shifted their testing to Christmas Island and to another set of islands. Where is that now? They can't remember anyway. And the earlier tests in the series were quite obviously, and this was what came out in the document program, quite obviously enormously big fission bombs. They were not hydrogen bombs, they were not thermonuclear bombs at all. They just wanted to make an enormous bang in order to impress the Americans. And of course the Americans are not stupid, the people who were working for it, and they figured out that the British didn't know how to make one. So then they obviously thought, well, what should we do? Because at that time there was an enormous reaction in the world to fallout, which basically followed on from the United States testing in the Marshall Islands of the big Castle Bravo bomb that blew up Bikini and made it into Bikini. So it blew the atoll in half, so you had two halves. And that's why you've got Bikinis now. That landed in as far away as Japan, and it wiped out a load of people on the Japanese fishing vessel called the Fukuyura Maru, or Lucky Dragon, not very lucky in fact, that was more than 150 miles away. So this all got into the media, and at that, so there was enormous pressure all over the world from the public who were realising that there was strontium 90 getting into the milk that their children were drinking, to stop nuclear testing. And so my feeling is that what happened is that the United States thought, well, we need to have somebody on our side. We need to have another country on our side that's independent of America, so we can both have bombs. Then it looks like more like the free world and their bombs versus the Soviet Union and their bombs. It's not just the United States on its own. So at that point, I think somebody made an executive decision to give the British the formulae for the bomb and then to control the British from then on. And I think that is what happened. I think from then on, from the point in time where the United States gave the formula for the bomb to the British and gave and flew the uranium for the bomb into Greenham Common Air Base, Britain had became a sort of offshore fortress of the United States military. And of course, from then on, we know that that's exactly what did happen, that we our own independent nuclear deterrent bomb, Red Beard and Blue, whatever it was, Blue Streak or something, those were just quietly abandoned. And the British took on the United States missile deployment. So we had the United States in Britain with their missiles in Britain, all pointing at Russia, or the Soviet Union. And then we had the Polaris submarines, which fire missiles built in the United States. So I think that Great Britain has been a puppet of the United States since that time. And this is a very important sort of, if you like, geopolitical issue, because it leads us forward to the point in time now where we're considering possibilities of nuclear war between the free world and the evil empire, which has now become Putin and Russia. And what we saw is that just as the United States acquired Tony Blair and Britain in their pursuit of Saddam Hussein, which was totally insane. I mean, anyone thinking back on it now realizes that we were just the puppy dog of the United States as far as Saddam Hussein was concerned. We invented a load of nonsense about him, we attacked him, we destroyed him. And look at Iraq now. And we used radioactive weapons. And then, of course, the same thing in Libya. And then, of course, the same thing in Syria. So what we see is the true nature of a sort of militaristic machine based in the United States, which began in the 1950s and has just gone from strength to strength since then. And anyone who stood in its way, like President Kennedy, gets shot. So we're talking about some serious people here, and maybe they'll get me as well. Anyway, maybe the goddess will save me. But I just wanted to say something about that, because there's more to it, this business of the United States giving Britain the uranium, than just saying, oh, well, let's give Britain some uranium. They don't do it for fun. There's no such thing as a free lunch. They did it because they needed to have a political ally in the production of nuclear weapons. And there's only one reason for the production of nuclear weapons, and that's to win a war using nuclear weapons. And what I say is that's not possible. Nobody can win a war with nuclear weapons. And that's where I am. That's where I am. That's where I am with the European Committee on Radiation Risk. We show through our research and by citing other people's research that small amounts of radioactivity, tiny amounts of these new substances like strontium-90 and these particles of uranium which never existed throughout evolution, cause massive, massive effects to the human genome. And of course, also effects to the genome of all living systems on Earth. So we can't win a nuclear war. And any of you who have any sort of power or energy or influence or anything at all in this area, you should get this message out as widely as possible, that the world is going down the toilet because of the United States of America. Or rather, as some people would say, whoever's running the show there, because, you know, the ordinary Americans don't know what's going on. I mean, it's not the people in the United States of America that we have to deal with, it's the Pentagon. Thank you very much.